Hi guys, today it's a very different type of video. There will be no visual support for it, so sorry in advance for those of you who are used to my usual type of video. I just wanted to give you my thoughts on UFC 246, and the reason I felt the need to publish that type of video is because of the criticism surrounding this card, and especially everything else but the main event. And I disagree with that criticism. The last thing I want is for casual fans or even normal fight fans to look at that card and say, well, it's pretty much only the main event. I'm not too interested about the rest of the card, so I'm going to wait for the main event to get excited. I really don't want that to happen. I think it's going to be an extremely exciting card, and I just wanted to show you guys why you should be excited for UFC 246 as a whole. So there's a principle for massive cards. Of course, I can understand the criticism for UFC 246 because there are not many great names all over the card. But let me tell you something, the UFC knows what they're doing. The last thing the UFC wants during those super massive events is to show boring fights, especially on the main card. They know everyone tunes in for the main event, so adding a guy like Jones or a guy like Adesanya or a guy like Romero on the co-main event or on the main card would be stupid from a financial standpoint because it doesn't add to the value of the pay-per-view for them. That being said, a boring fight on the main card of an event like this can make the difference between a casual fan and a paying customer. When the numbers are high, the UFC provides. The matchmakers never get any credit, but they're literally geniuses of MMA as far as styles and skills go. Believe me when I say, this card will be extremely entertaining, because every fighter will have the chance to show their skills because of the nice matchups the UFC matchmakers have made. So just to start, there are some insane odds for that fight card. I mean, Pettis is a 3-1 underdog. Cowboy is almost a 4-1 underdog, which is crazy. But before we get into that, let's look at the most interesting aspects of some of these fights on the UFC 246 fight card. First, Macy Barber versus Roxanne Modafferi. Modafferi looks like the least threatening person on earth. She's like a 7-1 underdog, which is almost disrespectful. Macy Barber, on the other hand, looks like the type of girl to smile when her face bleeds. Two warriors that never ever quit. For sure an exciting fight. Next, Drew Dober versus Nasrat Akparast. Dober is a gatekeeper. There's no way around that, but he's very skillful and he's also a tough SOB. Tough test for anyone in the division, even for Akparast, who's a very promising prospect. Expect an action-packed war between these two, and also, watch for Nasrat's power hand. It's quick as fuck. Next, Tim Elliott versus Askar Askarov. For me, this is one of the most exciting fights of this card. Askarov is the kind of guy that has tremendous abilities, but his weaknesses are pretty glaring and sometimes really bad. Elliott, on the other hand, has many weird techniques. He's very awkward with his style, and I like it a lot. And Askarov is kind of awkward as well when you think about it. But these two are just dynamic wild men, and it's going to be very interesting to see them fight. Andre Fili versus Sadiq Youssef. I'm going to be honest with you, this is a potential snooze fest if they don't take risks. Both like to keep the distance, they don't like to be in the pocket, so it's going to be very interesting to see who can be the slickest, who can place his shots better than the other one. It's going to be very interesting to see, but again, I'm warning you, it might not be the most exciting fight of the card, so if you take a bathroom break, this is the one. Anthony Pettis versus Diego Ferreira. I honestly don't know why the odds are the way they are for this fight. Yes, Ferreira has great cardio, a complete game, and a fantastic chin, but Pettis knocked out Wonderboy. If you can KO Wonderboy, you can KO anyone in the world. But odds makers are not stupid, and we might see Pettis completely outmatched in this fight, and that, in itself, is pretty impressive. Claudia Gadela versus Alexa Grasso. Let me tell you something about these fighters. Both girls always find a way to be in close fights. I don't know why, but they're always in tight battles. So don't be surprised if that fight's a war. Alex Jelinek versus Maurice Greene. Have you ever seen someone getting hugged to death? Because that's what Olenek does. That dude has 70 pro MMA fights, and he's specialized in the Ezekiel choke. If you've never seen that, it's a very personal submission. It's essentially a hug. And I call it the seduction submission because it's so personal and so intimate, and it might happen at UFC 246. And another reason why this fight is a sleeper on that card is because Olenek has 10 fights in the UFC. One has ended in decision, two have ended in the second round, and seven have ended in the first round. For Green, 3 out of 4 of his UFC fights have ended in the first round. Holly Holm versus Raquel Pennington. This is the co-main event. Both have fought to a split decision before, but Holly has a style that stays somewhat the same throughout the years. Of course, she can adapt. She did that against Megan Anderson, and she took her down. But I personally believe that Pennington might have the advantage for this one, considering the fact that she can evolve for Holly more than Holly can evolve for her. But of course, it's just a theory. It's going to be very interesting to see if Holm can place a nice night-ending head kick. And of course, the main event of the evening, Conor McGregor versus Cowboy Cerrone. What has not been said about this fight? Everything has been said about this one, but I'm going to tell you why I personally get excited when I think about these two in the octagon. Well, first, Conor said that he can read Donald like a children's book. And when I think about that statement, I believe that, yes, Cowboy is kind of predictable. He's kind of stiff. He's not the fastest. And his tricks are pretty easily readable, but not all of them. And Conor, normally when someone says that they can read someone very, very easily, that's normally when they will get surprised by an attack they didn't see coming. And that might happen to Conor. Donald has some tricks up his sleeve. And it's going to be very interesting to see if he can get Conor flat-footed, you know? Also, it's the first time we see Conor disrespectful of his opponent, so it's going to be very interesting to see if he can have the same performance as usual. Another thing that I think not many people have considered is the consequences of a loss to Cowboy are potentially devastating. I mean, think about this. If Conor loses to Cowboy, how is it going to end? Well, maybe by submission, but Conor has been submitted before. It's more like he gets taken down, he gets battered, he gets beat, he quits, and then people get the submission over him. But it's never been like a quick submission in the first round that he just gets caught in it and he just cannot get out. It's not like that. He gets beat very, very violently before his losses by submission. And of course, a knockout by Cowboy could be a career ender. Imagine if we see a McGregor Gillespie. This is very, very intriguing to think about. And even if he loses by decision, the third way to lose a fight. Remember what happened to Iaquinta. After the fight, Iaquinta didn't even want to stay in the octagon. He wanted to go see the doctor because he was worried for his health. And that tells you how much Cowboy can put a beating on a guy, especially for 5 rounds. I mean, Cowboy has significantly more pounds on him than Conor does. And he won against guys that are 30 plus pounds heavier than Conor. This is something to think about. Another thing, Cowboy is pretty tall. And against tall guys, Conor tends to overextend. That's what he did against Diaz. Maybe he's not going to do the same mistake against Cowboy, but it's going to be interesting to see how he gauges that longer range from a 170 pounder. And of course, everyone has said that Cowboy is a slow starter, especially under pressure, but I think he might have a psychological advantage because this fight is not for the title. When Cowboy fought for the title in the past, he had some pretty bad performances, but I think he put some more pressure on himself because it's for the title, and this one is not. So he might perform under pressure because he doesn't feel it, and that's a possibility. And of course, you know, I'm really thinking in my head how this fight might play out. And if Donald throws many, many kicks, it's going to be very interesting to see how Conor reacts to them, because I think he's going to try to counter, maybe catch one of them, but he's going to get exposed at some point if he doesn't win easily in the first or second round. What if Conor throws body shots on Cowboy? That might be interesting as well. You know, there are so many things that can happen, but there is no way, there is no scenario in my head that this fight is not extremely entertaining. And of course, you already knew that. You're already excited for this one. But please, don't wait for the main event to get excited. It's gonna be a good night, trust me.
We're gonna blow the fucking roof off this place, you guys. You don't understand. I'm so excited for this fight. So excited.
So please, guys, tell me what you thought about this video. I don't plan to do some more of these because I really just wanted to give you my thoughts on UFC 246 as a whole. But if you liked it and you'd like to hear my thoughts on it, please tell me in the comments. And if you didn't like, please tell me in the comments as well. Have a good